when that song came about, I was really into Glassjaw. And for some reason, not that it sounds anything at all like Glassjaw, but that inspired me. And I think there were some lyrics about a pretty girl or something, if I remember correctly. And I had just met my wife. She wasn't my wife then, because I just met her. She is now. And so the word pretty came to my mind. I had this melody, you're only pretty, whatever it is. And that's kind of how that came about. And then on the chorus, my son, who was about 10 years old at the time, came up to me and said, hey Dad, I came up with this line. And the line was, hypothetical, a medical man who speaks Greek. And that's what he said to me. I thought, okay, I'm going to incorporate that into a song. It ended up being this song. And the funny thing about that line, and this is the reason I mentioned it, is that, I don't know if anybody's aware, but I've had 2 heart attacks. But I'm doing great. And I think the heart attacks have been good for me. You know, they actually, I think, made me better in some ways. But my cardiologist is a medical man, and he speaks Greek to me. Mm-hmm. I'm in his office, and he'll just start speaking Greek. And I thought, that's quite interesting. I told him that just the other day, and he thought that was quite interesting, too. So there you go. What's your take on that song, man?
I love that song. It's one of the
first... I do. It's one of my favorites, too.
I think that was, like, the moment, you know, when we kind of completed the idea, and we knew where we wanted it to go, you know, and doing some, you know, arranging. And I just think that was a moment where we're like, man, I think we can, like, keep doing this stuff over and over again, because we kept high-fiving, so to speak. Every time we like finished something, we're like, yeah, dude. And there's like a really awesome epic ending where we bring in like strings and stuff like that, and there's just like a lot of stuff to listen to, and it was a really full, heavy, you know, heavy drumming. Just got a lot of heavy, heavy parts in that. And it's, it was real fun to put together.
Waking Up, that my good friend Bob Berger, who is I think is a great singer-songwriter, very, very talented man. I play in his band locally whenever I can, and always great players, and I totally enjoy doing that. He played bass on that song. I think it's great, along with Earl Slick as well on that one, and Andy Blacksugar. It's a shame that I'm so... I don't really like talking a lot about what lyrics mean, because to me, to do that, in a sense, takes away any possible meaning that could be there for you. And I sure don't want to do that. Very close to the way I wrote it.
Pretty much the arrangement.
Yeah, the arrangement.
We did like a really cool like vocal backdrop on it with some big choruses. Put a little bit of a Brian May guitar spice in there. And David Parks put those drums in there, like really cool tribal drums, a lot of stuff going on, but really bare, just the way Jerry kind of wrote it initially. Not a lot of change as far as arrangements.
That was a song I actually brought to King's X during the one of the records. I think it was Overtones. It's called Never Ever Know. Yeah, it was Overtones. Of course we didn't do it. But that's okay. We're doing it now. That's a song, again, I was just doodling on the guitar, hum up some chords, melody came into my head. Very incomplete idea. Just had that one part for like a verse, sort of pre-chorusy kind of thing or whatever.
And that's before we knew what we were going to do with it later.
Yeah, had no idea.
And when we were here at Michael Wagner's doing drums, you know, we're like, you know what? Let's get like a fast-paced song to kind of like, you know, stick in the middle of the record or wherever it may be, end up. And like, let's just turn the BPM up and let Jerry just kind of play whatever. So that he was playing to like really no music with no really idea that we're going to use the song that he wrote with this drum beat, you know? So we had these drums at the end of the day, killer stuff, you know, like 6 or 7 minutes of just Jerry playing different beats and stuff like that. And then we're like, you know what, why don't we take these drums and just kind of meld it with that idea that you had. And it turned out to be more of a rockin' tune, you know? And it's the last song to really complete on the record. It's the last song that we kind of looked at, and it was just like a spur of the moment thing, and it just happened to work with the initial idea, and it was a really cool gelling, in a sense. Take what you need for today. Let us have our peace when you move on. Run away, go away. Take from us your worthy pay. Sunday light, you're all like vampires too. That's a song that I came up with on the piano. On the pianto. Yeah, I was very excited about that one. My wife's uncle gave us a piano. And I just sat down. And these chords came out again. Melody came into my head. I wrote a song and I got very excited about it. And this is in the earlier stages of us working together, kind of. And we're already excited about everything we're doing. And I remember talking to Dan one day on the phone saying, man, we haven't even heard the piano song yet. Yeah, it's a good one.
And the chorus talks about a girl named Patty who cuts my hair. And she asked me one day, she said, why don't you write a song about me? I said, okay, I will. So I just incorporated her into the chorus, her cutting my hair and the conversations we had. That's why we call it Patty's song. The rest of the song has nothing to do with her.
She doesn't have to know that, though.
Well, right, but yeah, she, well, we'll, if you think her of the lyrics, I think she'd want it not to be about her.
Yeah. Something very haunting about that song. Something very dark and very trance-like. It's a good one. Light, can you see me? Can you see me? I want to go to paradise.
Song called Paradise, Phil Keggy played on it. And Dan and I went over to his place. he was happy to do it. He told me, oh, I'll be glad to do it. It'll be my gift to you for serving me for that time back in 1980, because I was in his band. And that's how he put it. For serving me, I'll do this for you. And we're in his basement, and we played the song for him. And it just seemed like he just heard it one time and just started ripping off these most amazing things that I've ever heard. And this is something I never think, I never really feel. I don't even think it's a possible thing to feel or think or to be. But I'm sitting there watching him play, and I'm going, I think Phil Cage is the best guitar player in the world.
That's what you said.
And that's the way it felt to me at the time.
He did some amazing stuff, like right out of the gate. He just knew what he heard the song once or twice.
Yeah, he just
and he laid it down, and it was just like perfect, you know. Yep. Such a great guitar player, you know.
Yeah. And a great guy.
Yeah.
And I find that's where I am.
I'll tell you how it came about. I had a guy I know who was a guitar player, and he told me he hasn't played in years and years. His guitar is under the bed. You know, he just raised his family. I didn't even think about playing guitar anymore. But it used to be what he did. He was a guitar player. I just said to him, well, why don't you just get the guitar out? Just play a couple chords. Play D and A minor. Just do it and see what happens. I think those are the chords I said. And so I went home and said, well, I'm gonna play those chords and see what they sound like. And I did. And this melody came into my head. And I just kind of took it from there. And I brought that one to Dan. And then he kind of switched it up and slowed it down and made it into a minor key.
Yeah. Yeah, that was one little small adjustment. Was just the name of the song's called Sad, so some of the music could have been a little sadder. So I just changed one little note in the melody, changed the chord from a major in one of the verses or whatever to a minor, and then it just, that was it. Everything just opened up, you know, and we wrote a chorus for it, and now it's like this huge, heavy, sad, emotional, and then the lyrics just kind of came to life, you know, and you really feel all the emotion, and he sang it really appropriate, really sparse and lonely, and it just...
That's why I love Dan so much.
Oh, I love you too.
Oh, thanks.
And it just everything just is just working for the vibe of the song and for the title. Sad. Magic.
There's a girl in the warehouse. She thinks low of herself, and she takes it all out on me. She cries in the doorway and she laughs at her school.
That's an older song that I wrote probably, when did I write that? Probably early 90s. Yeah. I submitted that to a King's X record too. And we never did it. But we're doing it now. Yeah, it's just another tune I came up with playing the guitar. I think it actually was inspired by my ex-wife, who was a great singer. She wrote songs. And she was teaching me some chords and things. I threw some in there and I liked the way they sounded. So again, the melody popped into my head. I wrote some lyrics and there it is, became a song. I actually recorded it with an acoustic guitar, playing it live into my computer on some stupid program or something, or just into my computer. And I could barely even play it because I can't really play that well. And I did the whole thing live. And I think even at the end, I said, shit, man, why can't it just be fucking easy or something?
Yes.
And I sent it to Dan, and it just turned into a great song. Again, Dan.
So
that's my idea.
It's all Jared.
So tell me, when you heard the, when you said it's all you, I mean, what were your thoughts?
I heard
it's not
a great
all him. Did I say it was all him?
Yeah, you said it was all him, but that's
no. That's
I take that
said.
Back.
I didn't mean that. It's all me, but Dan liked it, so it's cool.
I can't remember how I
well,
heard
up,
it.
Dan. We don't need that now.
Forget
I'm
it.
I'm just kidding.
I can't remember if I heard it on the phone. It sounded like a voicemail recording. And
yeah, that's
Jerry,
how bad it was.
It was really a rough recording. And I was trying to make out the chords that he was playing, because he holds these really interesting chords. I don't know how you come up with really cool stuff, but chords that I would never hold that way, you know, which is a really neat way to actually get inspired to write. So I'm trying to figure out like what key it's in and that type of thing. And I just kind of dressed it up. I kind of mapped it all out, whatever, and heard the lyrics. You sent me the lyrics. Mm-hmm. And I just kind of mapped it out and arranged it out and kind of like threw a band, like a pseudo band, just to kind of see what it would sound like with a band. And when Jerry heard it, he loved it. And then we moved things around after that a little bit. Tried different types of vocal backdrops and made it kind of trippy in some parts. And I really loved going away.
Goodbye song. Here's my recollection of that. I remember Dan said, I got some ideas for songs too. Let me play some stuff. So he was sitting there with his acoustic guitar, tell me if I'm wrong. He's playing some stuff and going, all right, playing some other stuff. Then he went into the Goodbye song. I said, now that I like, that's great. Let's do that. And he had no lyrics or anything. So.
Yeah, I had this like this just fun little, it's not a, like a ragtime thing, but it's got all these changes and like chromatic scales, kind of Beatlesque, you know, something Paul McCartney might like fiddle with, you know, that type of style. I had a little bit of a melody there, and I really dug it, you know, it's really kind of like a venture from not what the record, it's definitely its own thing, you know, and Jerry liked it,
yes,
went into the other room for like 10 minutes and came back with these wonderful lyrics, and it basically thanking everybody who's been
thank
a part of the record.
Thank everybody for being a part of the record and just for everything.
And it's a cute little ditty.
Yeah, it's kind of, I kind of see it as a song at the end of the record, you know, at the end of a show when they're dancing off the stage with their cane and kicking it like, see you later, that kind of thing.
Yeah.